Okay. Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to the webinar with Sacred Heart University. We have a presentation by Francesca de Rizzo, the Director of International Admission at Sacred Heart University. And she's going to talk about a Catholic liberal arts education in New England. And at the end, we'll have a little bit of time for Q&A. I'm Caitlin. I'm the Consejera Educativa at the Fulbright Commission here in Bogota, Colombia. And now I will give the floor over to Francesca.
Thank you very much. So hello everybody and welcome to this webinar. I'm here, my name is Francesca. As you were told, I'm the Director of International Admissions at Sacred Heart, and I'm here with Manuela, our student, originally from Bogota herself, who's gonna also share with you her experience here at Sacred Heart. So we're gonna get started. We are going to, let's see. There we go. We're gonna get started talking in general about what is New England, where New England is, what does it mean to get a study abroad experience done in this area. So as you can see from this little map on the left, New England is this area in the northeastern corner of the United States. It includes six states, among which, as again, is Connecticut, which is where we are located. It's very well connected in terms of international flights, international travels, because of especially two big cities that were very close, if not included, in this territory, which are New York City and Boston. So flying internationally to this area is very easy, and a lot of local airports also help you with getting to local smaller towns. So what is typical about New England? Something, probably the first thing that you might notice, especially from a Colombian background, is definitely the weather and the seasons. So here in Connecticut and all New England, people get to experience all four seasons during the year. So it's not, unfortunately, spring all year round. We actually get to experience summer, fall, winter, so all four seasons with all that they imply. So for example, right now it's October, we are in full autumn or fall season. So the picture that you see up there with those, you know, colorful trees that turn like yellow, orange, red, that's what is happening right now if we step outside our campus, and you're going to see a couple of pictures later as well. This is a big season where everybody likes to celebrate, enjoy the last, you know, warm time of the year. A lot of festival happens, and obviously a lot of food is involved in there as well. So there's some typical, you know, food that you get to try in this area of the United States as well. That funny picture of the lobster that you see there is just a reminder that, again, we are on the ocean, okay? Almost all our states, except for Vermont, are, you know, right on the ocean. So seafood is big in this area. You get to, obviously, I mentioned this festival, a lot of this fair festival food, a lot of fried food, and not necessarily good for you, but it's very fun and interesting to enjoy. I mentioned again all four seasons, therefore we're gonna get into winter in a few months. So yes, it snows in New England, and it's not warm and nice all year. So especially the month of January and February are the colder ones. We do get some snow. A lot of our students get to go enjoy obviously this weather as well. So on the local mountains, there are opportunities to go sliding, skiing, or playing in the snow. And sometimes if the snow gets quite bad for one day or two, it's sometimes also like the occasion to get a day off from school, because again, sometimes it's really hard to get outside. That's really only asked for a couple of months. Then spring and summer are beautiful seasons here. It's what, especially spring, and what you experience in Colombia as well. But it gets quite warmer than it is in Bogota here in the summer months. That for us are June, July, and August. So our university, I said we were talking about, you know, studying in New England, studying in a Catholic university. We're clearly not the only Catholic university in this country. There's about 200 Catholic colleges or universities in the United States. They all share, obviously, something which is a Catholic mission, Catholic values, but they all can express it in a different way. All those bullet points that I try to list on the top right corner of the slide, you know, list different, let's say, options that you might find in Catholic schools. You might find a Catholic school run by the Jesuit order, or Catholic school run by Franciscan order, or other religious orders, or like Sacred Heart Universities, a Catholic university only run by lay faculty, lay staff. What does it mean? It means that our university, which was funded after the Second Vatican Council in 1963, was, yes, founded by the bishop of our diocese, so a religious person. However, the whole managing and teaching, the whole real action in the university was always given from day one to lay people, so not necessarily religious people. We do have a beautiful chapel on our campus, as you can see from this couple of pictures. We're going to talk a little bit about what does that imply for a student to study in a Catholic university. But what really matters to us here at Sacred Heart is to really just put our students at the center of our mission and be here to help them grow, and not just growing academically, you know, about what they study, but about what they do all year round. And so, for example, community service and volunteering is a big part of what our students do, no matter if they do share the Catholic faith or not. And just as a piece of information, we do have students from 33 countries around the world. Both American and international students are not necessarily Catholic students. They're Muslim students, Indian students who really, by approach to university, having never gone to church in the past. But this is not by any mean a point that for the university to not accept or deny a student to our community. We are also, and this is like probably the hardest point to explain, a liberal arts university. There are several, many liberal arts schools throughout the United States, and this is probably a very different concept that is, again, unique compared to higher education institution in other countries around the world. What does it mean? I copied here this definition by the Merriam-Webster dictionary that you can read. But to try to translate it, to keep it simpler, studying in a liberal arts university means studying in a university that is not only focused on offering classes to students in the field and the subject that they have selected as their major, as their main topic of study, but in helping them grow 360 degrees. So helping them, put themselves into discussion, develop critical thinking skills, judgment skills, reasoning skills. So let's say, and Manuela is gonna actually help us better understand in a few minutes what it means, helping them step outside their field of study that could be computer engineering or business or history, and actually explore other subjects, other areas with a more personal approach. So I'll let Manuela tell you a little bit about this so that you can better understand what a student here at Sacred Heart experiences studying in this type of university.
Hola, buenos días. Soy Manuela Contreras, estoy estudiando de mi último año acá en Sagrado Corazón y quería hablar un poquito con ustedes de cómo es estudiando acá en Sagrado Corazón y como estudiante en esta área de Estados Unidos. Lo que me gusta mucho de poder estudiar en una universidad de liberal arts es poder tener la oportunidad de estudiar diferentes clases afuera de la carrera tuya. Por ejemplo, clases que te ayudan a entender la parte intelectual, espiritual, académico o científico, parte social, afuera de tu carrera, pero eso es súper importante porque te hace ver el mundo en los ojos de otras personas o te hace dar una perspectiva muy especial del mundo que a veces cuando estás estudiando, de verdad te enfocas en lo que tú estás estudiando y no puedes ver cómo las otras personas están viendo el mundo, de dónde vienen sus carreras, cómo ellos pueden también entender la situación que ustedes están. En mi experiencia, a mí me encantó mucho porque no solo me ayudó a entender más lo que yo quería hacer, pero también me ayudó en encontrar intereses en otras áreas del estudio dentro de la universidad. Por ejemplo, en mi primer año yo estaba estudiando biología y yo quería estudiar medicina para poder estudiar por todas partes del mundo. Y cuando comencé a estudiar más clases sociales y clases de filosofía o clases del mundo, entendí lo que yo podía hacer de ayudar el mundo, podía hacer en muchísimas diferentes capacidades y eso me cambió mucho como yo seguí mi carrera acá en la universidad. Y eso es lo que me gusta mucho de esto, que en muchas veces que hablas con las personas y los estudiantes de acá, ves cómo estas clases te ayudaron a entender más lo que tú quieres hacer. Sí. Oh, bueno, there we go. Y siguiendo con eso, también parte del ser una universidad católica es una cosa muy importante porque una de las clases que me encantó más era de una clase que acabamos de comenzar acá en la universidad el año pasado, que se llama la clase de intelectual tradicional católica. Y lo que fue tan especial de esta clase es que pudimos sentarnos con personas, con estudiantes de diferentes años, de diferentes carreras y de diferentes perspectivas de cómo ellos se sienten de la religión. Y puede ser su propia religión o puede ser la religión católica que siguen. Y en esta clase pudimos hablar mucho de lo que es cómo nuestra religión sigue al mundo y cómo la parte social de la parte justicia social está afectando nuestro mundo y cómo la parte religiosa de la parte cristiana implica en esa justicia social. Para mí eso fue muy importante porque eso es algo que yo soy muy apasionada y yo quiero hacer una carrera en eso, en poder traer más justicia a este mundo, pero lo que, como yo me conecté más, era la oportunidad de poder crecer mi propia relación con Dios. Y en esto lo que es bonito de esta universidad es, y en muchas universidades católicas, es que como ya estás en la universidad, tú ya eres independiente, tú no tienes tus papás que te van a decir, tienes que ir a la misa, ya es domingo, tienes que rezar todas las noches. Tú tienes la oportunidad de crecer tu relación con Dios como tú quieras. Y en nuestra universidad nos dan muchas oportunidades de hacer esto. Si es ir a la misa todos los domingos, que es muy bonita y te sorprendes ver muchos estudiantes ahí sin los papás, pero también lo que la parte que yo me he conectado más es la parte de voluntario, de poder ir en la comunidad, dentro de nuestra comunidad acá en la universidad o acá en el estado o también afuera del país. Y con esta experiencia es donde yo pude de verdad no solo conectarme con Dios, pero también conectarme con la persona que yo soy y crecer en la persona que yo quiero ser. Estas fotos que ves acá son unas fotos del el paseo que pudimos organizar con una fundación que se llama Levántate y Anda, que está en Bogotá. Y ya este es el cuarto año que estamos organizando un paseo de estudiantes que van una semana y ayudan a esta comunidad en Bogotá, en el barrio de San Fernando. Y es en estos paseos, en estos días de poder de verdad conectar con la comunidad y ayudar a las personas, aprender las culturas, aprender a escuchar dónde vienen las personas, ahí es cuando me parece que de verdad estamos siguiendo los valores de nuestra universidad, que es lo que me encanta. Y último, es pudiendo estudiar en esta área de los Estados Unidos. Yo nací en Bogotá y vine acá a Estados Unidos de muy chiquita, pero yo he vivido y he vivido en New Jersey casi toda mi vida. Pero yo todavía estoy muy conectada con mi familia en Bogotá, entonces yo he podido sentí la diferencia de estar en Bogotá y poder estar acá. Lo que me gusta mucho es de dónde está nuestra universidad, es donde es que está al lado de Nueva York y también al lado de Boston, pero también el estado de Connecticut es muy bonito porque puedes estar en la naturaleza, puedes ir a caminar en las montañas y como Francesca estaba diciendo, en el invierno puedes ir a esquiar y hacer todas esas cosas muy chévere, pero también,
La playa en
sí, la
verano.
playa, cuando entras a la universidad en agosto todavía está haciendo un calorcito rico y puedes ir a la playa, pero también lo bonito es que la universidad de verdad se enfoca en poder darle una experiencia súper chévere a los estudiantes y nos dan oportunidades de ir a conocer estas áreas. Entonces, por ejemplo, la semana pasada había una feria grandísima al lado de Boston, por ejemplo, y la universidad organizó buses para poder ir a esa feria grandísima para todos los estudiantes que querían ir y es muy chévere porque tú no te tienes que estresar de, ah, yo quiero ir y conocer, pero no sé cómo hacerlo. Y mi primer año, por ejemplo, que yo he estado en New Jersey muchos años, pero yo siempre quería ir a un show en Broadway, por ejemplo, y la universidad nos compró tiquetes y buses para ir a Nueva York a ver un show. Entonces, eso es lo bonito de acá, que nosotros de verdad nos enfocamos en darle a los estudiantes la experiencia. Que de todo, de poder de verdad tener una vida muy bonita acá. Entonces, por todo eso, yo tenía una experiencia muy bonita, me ha encantado poder estar acá y vivir en un área bonita, pero también crecer mucho y conocer muchas personas de diferentes lugares. Uno de mis mejores amigos son de Puerto Rico, de México, y desde acá, de Massachusetts, de por todo lado. Entonces es muy chévere y ojalá puedan venir.
Thank you very much. So we're gonna move on and actually look at, if you're, considering this area of the country, if you're interested in a liberal arts, Catholic university in New England, especially in Connecticut, you might become interested in learning more about Sacred Heart University. Sacred Heart is a university that means that offers programs of study both at the undergraduate level and at the pregrado and postgrado, so what we call undergraduate and graduate programs. Undergraduate programs, they all have a duration of 4 years, and they award students with a bachelor degree, Whereas graduate programs, they have different lengths. They can last from 1 to 2 years or more for doctorate programs. And they, again, award students with a master degree or doctorate degrees. So if you're high school students, you're finishing your high school career right now, you're going to look at the undergraduate programs. We have an offer of more than 70 majors at the undergraduate level. And they, as you can see from the list, they go from theater arts to business. Maybe Manuela, you want to tell us what you're studying now?
Yeah. So ahora estoy estudiando administración de empresas y estudios internacionales. Entonces es global studies and business management. Lo especial de esta, de poder estudiar esas dos carreras, es que están en dos diferentes colleges. El College de Arts and Sciences es donde estoy estudiando Global Studies, y el College de Business es donde estoy estudiando Administración de Empresas. Y lo bonito de los dos es que tienen dos diferentes, tienen muchas diferentes clases, pero son bien diferentes en cómo enseñan, las oportunidades que tienes en las dos colleges, y sí, te ayuda mucho.
And as you heard before, when Manuela started here at Sacred Heart, she began thinking that she wanted to become a doctor one day, so she had selected biology. The biology major has her main field of study, so that she could after that enter the School of Medicine. Well, as you heard, she's now studying something very, very different. How did she do that? So all our students have the opportunity, all are offered a personal academic advisor. An academic advisor in their college of studies is a person who's there to help them modify their study plan, understand what they like. Obviously, as Manuela explained, the liberal arts classes are very important for this matter as well, to think about what you really like, what you want to do, because it is normal if right now you don't know what you want to study and you're very undecided. It's okay. So this is why we offer academic advisors to all our students. By the end of the second year of study, they have the opportunity to modify their study plan, to change their major, to add two majors, okay? Like Manuel is an example, student can double major, that's what we say, when they select two different programs and just put them together and graduate in both programs, which is also something very different that most of the countries around the world do not allow. I mentioned, we talked about business, we talked about global studies, the College of Arts and Sciences, biology. We also have a College of Nursing, which is one of the most competitive programs that we offer at Sacred Heart, and College of Health Professions for health-related studies. At the graduate level, so if you're older students already studying in a university and would like to continue with a master degree or a doctorate degree, you see listed here below the programs offer that international students can take, because these are full-time programs. As well, they really go from, they still cover all those fields, so the arts and sciences, the business, the health professions, and at the moment, our university hosts about 8,500 students in total, so including undergraduate and graduate students. 8,500, yes, is a big number. However, we are considered a medium-sized university in the United States. We're not very small, like tiny little, sometimes private universities, or as big as 30,000 students or 40,000 students when we look at larger school or state universities. So we are a medium-sized university. I mentioned before, our students come from 33 countries around the world and from 26 different states within the United States. If you're interested in any of these programs, so what is that that you need to do? Obviously, well, you can contact me and I'll provide you with my contacts later, but all students interested in a program needs to fill out an application for the university. You find here the information on the left about what is required to apply for an undergraduate program or for a graduate program. The requirements are not very different. Obviously, the first most important thing the student needs to send, that it's almost not even listed here because it's so obvious, but are the transcripts of the student. If you're a high school student, you need to obtain from your school your transcripts, all your marks, your grades, because we need to see if you are a good student or a bad student, so if we can accept you in our university. Same thing if you are a university student. You need to obtain from your university your transcripts for the same purpose. Some international tests, if you're familiar with them, normally are required in a lot of applications. For Sacred Heart University, for the applications for undergraduate programs, we do not require the SAT, the SAT, or the ACT tests. We are optional. It means that if you don't have the opportunity or we're not really planning to take some of these standardized American tests, it's okay. You can still apply. We do not need those tests. At the graduate level, you might know of GMAT and GRE tests. Those are, generally speaking, not required. They are only required if you are interested in a graduate program in the College of Business, like the MBA or the Master in Digital Marketing or in Finance. So those, yes, those require one of those two tests. The other requirements are pretty pretty easy, pretty standard, but very, very important, and you find this on the right side of the slide, is the English language component. Before we accept a student, we need to make sure that he will be able to succeed in class, to understand the professors, to do his homeworks, his assignments, to interact with the other students in the class and make friends. So this is why, if your first language is not English, we do ask for an English language test. What you see listed there, maybe some of them might be familiar to you, like the TOEFL, like the IELTS, they're probably the two most popular tests. And you see next to their names what the minimum score required for admission is. You also would see in that list something called SHU, ESL test. So SHU, it's the way we call Sacred Heart University in just a shortened form. And so Sacred Heart ESL test means that, yes, we do have our online test for the English language. Our university actually offers, has its own English Language Institute. So there's international students that only come to Sacred Heart to study the English language. Therefore, our Institute of English Language has developed a test to assess the level of English. And we can offer this test as an alternative to the TOEFL or the IELTS if a student needs, again, an alternative and is not able to access any of these tests. You probably are also interested in knowing that we do offer scholarships to international students. Unfortunately, for now, only at the undergraduate level. So if you are a high school student who would like to come to Sacred Heart for his bachelor degree, you will be considered for our academic scholarship. Our academic scholarship depends on your high school grades, and every student who is accepted to Sacred Heart University for a bachelor program receives from a minimum of 7,000 to a maximum of 16,000 American dollars per year. per year means that if you remain a good student all 4 years at Sacred Heart, we keep giving you the same scholarship every single year. And another interesting scholarship for undergraduate students is the one related to the performing arts. So if a student is interested in participating in one of our performing art groups, for example, our theater group, or our dance group, our choir, our band, no matter what he studies. So you can be marketing students or chemistry students, and simply choose one of these performing arts as your extracurricular activity. You also receive an additional scholarship from $1,500 to $4,000 per year. So this also can be obviously an interesting opportunity for all the undergraduate students. At the moment, we do not offer scholarships for graduate international students here at Sacred Heart. The last point that I would like to mention is the college credit transfer process. It means that, let's say that you've started university in Colombia or somewhere else. It can be another American university, it can be a Colombian university, or somewhere else, anywhere else in the world. And you would like to transfer to Sacred Heart. So you would like to not complete your university where you are now, but change and come here and finish your degree program here. Well, you can do that. You can apply as a transfer student, and we would be we do offer the option to transfer your college credits, your university credits. If you are attending a university outside the United States, you would need to present to us an evaluation, okay, of your foreign transcripts done by an external agency. I listed here on the slide WES, WES, which is probably the one that we see more often, that most students use, but your advisors at Education USA or the Fulbright office are, I'm sure they're also available to help you with getting in touch with these offices if necessary. If instead you are attending already a university somewhere in the United States and you simply like to transfer, then there is no need to provide some of these documents. If you are, again, still in high school and you are attending a school that offers IB exams or AP exams, those are also credits that our university can take and transfer into university credits. So again, also if you are in that situation, feel free to contact us for more questions. In general though, whatever question you might have, I invite you to get in touch with us. As I said, you can reach out obviously to your Fulbright, to your Education USA office, or for questions more specific about Sacred Heart, please feel free to contact our Office of International Admissions. My name is Francesca De Rizzo. You see my email address here. And Manuela, who talked to you about her experience, is also available to answer your questions. So we also share her email address. Obviously, feel free to visit our website. Feel free to check our social media. We are on Facebook. We are on Snapchat. We have our YouTube channel. We are on Instagram, so follow us, just check what our students do, what happens on our campus, and remember that choosing a university for your future, no matter what the university is, it's a big personal decision, which is going to impact many years of your life, and one of the most important years of your life. So you want to make sure you make the right decision. So as I said, feel free to explore pictures, videos, contact us, contact our students, and if you're if that's an option for you, if you can, also feel free to visit us in person. We do offer campus tours every day, so there's always students and families visiting us. And for those who cannot, we offer a virtual campus tour on our website. So by going on www.sacredheart.edu, at the bottom of the main page, you find a link to take a virtual tour of our beautiful campus. So I'm done, I think, with what I had prepared to talk to you about. So
great, Francesca, thank you so much for that presentation, and Manuela, thank you for your insight as a student.
No problem.
I do have a couple of questions for you. The first one is, you said there's no scholarships for graduate students, but are there assistantships like research or teaching or administrative assistance?
Yes, there are opportunities such as graduate, what we call GA, so graduate assistantships, research opportunities. For example, I can bring you the example of Katomi. She's our graduate assistant in our Office of International Admissions this year. She's a student from Japan, and she actually came to Sacred Heart for her bachelor degree, and she decided to continue here at Sacred Heart with an MBA, sorry, Master in Business Administration, and we had a position open for graduate assistant in our office. So this, for example, for her is an opportunity to obviously, you know, finance herself to pay for most of the tuition for her programs. But a lot of offices around campus, and so they like ours, so they don't have to be necessarily professor's office, department office. They can be, again, the Office of International Admissions, it can be the study abroad office, it can be the financial aid office. They do have positions like this one open.
Okay, great. Thanks so much. And then my other question is about kind of like international student life. So for undergraduate and then graduate students, international students, do they usually live on or off campus? And what kinds of housing options are there?
Okay, so at Sacred Heart University, we do offer for undergraduate students housing for all 4 years if necessary. So we have residence halls, we have dorms on campus. At the moment, I know that for our freshman class, so the first year students, 95% of them live on campus. The percentage goes down for the following years because a lot of students decide that, well, they start making friends, they decide that maybe they want to just rent an apartment on their own, but we do offer campus housing for all 4 years. Half, I want to say, yeah, on average, half of our residence halls are located on campus. Half of our residence halls are located off campus. And what I mean by off campus could be, for example, like a 5-minute shuttle ride down on Park Avenue, which is the main road that where we are located. So or like across the street. So they're not physically on the campus where the other academic buildings are, but they're all reachable very, very easily and connected, if again, further away, a few minutes away, connected with campus shuttles. Graduate students are not guaranteed campus housing. There is a small percentage of our beds available to graduate students. Most of them get very easily settled down in local apartments. We are what is considered a suburban campus. So we are not in the middle of the big city, but we're not neither in the middle of nowhere. So it's a very, it's a residential area where we are located. So houses, apartments around us are pretty much all used by our graduate students or undergraduate students if they decide not to enjoy our dorms. Our dorms are all, first of all, they're more and more because our university has been growing in the past few years and very rapidly. We are just terminating, like here behind my office, they're finishing now the works for a brand new upper class dorm, which will be inaugurated in the month of December. We have a couple of also other dorms that have been opened last summer. They offer different options. Some of them are apartment style, some other are double rooms or suite style. So they, again, they give options to single rooms, double rooms, triple rooms. Some of the, I guess, especially the most recent ones have like the extra, let's say, facilities available, such as a CrossFit gym or a video gaming studio for our video gaming team, or a gym, for example, study areas, of course. And they're very, very safe, meaning that Fairfield is, by the way, been ranked the 24 safest college town in the US 3 weeks ago. And the and all our dorms, all our public safety works very, very hard to keep our students safe. So, for example, only a student that lives in a specific dorm is allowed to enter that dorm using his personal ID, his badge, his card. There's always, again, safety systems around campus. The campus is always patrolled by, you know, like a police trooper, campus safety, as I said. So living on campus is, as we suggest to our students, the best option, not only to, you know, be taken care of in a way, but also to enjoy campus life. So to participate in our performing arts event, sports event. We have a lot of sport activities happening on campus, including 32 teams who compete at the in Division One. So there's a lot of, you know, sport games on campus as well, guest lectures, events, and living on campus gives students the opportunity to enjoy all this without worrying too much about transportation and so on.
Great, thank you so much.
No problem.
And then my last question is, what's your percentage of international students and what are some of the services that you offer for international students?
Mm-hmm. So I will give a separate answer for undergraduate and graduate students. At the graduate level, there's a number of about almost 500 international students on a total of 3,700 students. So the percentage, the number of international students there is it's pretty high. At the graduate level, instead, the percentage is much lower, but also way more diverse than at the graduate level. So at the moment, there's a maximum maybe 100 international students, in the undergraduate level, as again, who are international on a total of more than 4,000 students. So the percentage is not very high. The diversity is very, very high instead, meaning that this group of students come from Colombia, Japan, Italy, Slovenia, Canada, China, Spain, Mexico, Brazil. So it's very diverse. And at the same time, we definitely would like to welcome a larger group of international students. And we, especially in the past 2 years, we started working very hard on it. But what we hear from a lot of our international students as well is that by choosing Sacred Heart, they knew that they were choosing a school where they were gonna totally immerse themselves in an American experience. They know that if they want, they have the opportunity to interact with other international students, to speak their language. For example, I can think of, there's a among our student clubs, I can think of La Hispanidad, which is one of our, you know, Spanish speaking student club on campus. So they know that they have opportunities to interact with other international students, but they also know that they're not constantly surrounded by them. So they can easily make friends among the American students. And again, obviously practice and improve their English, and obviously, again, live that American experience. In terms of services that you were asking about, obviously our Office of International Admissions is an office composed of four people plus our graduate assistant, who is uniquely dedicated to working with international applicants. So international applicants have a team of people who specifically works with them, who specifically travels also around the world to meet with them, and who receive their application. We have a different office that we work with here on campus, a team of three people, which is our Immigration Support Services Office, and their job, their service is 100% on the immigration documents, on the visa, student visa process for our international students. And they are also the office where international students, once on campus, can go to when they, for example, need to travel outside the United States for some reason. When they, you know, go back at the end of their academic experience, when they would like to ask questions about applying for the optional practical training for OPT, for example. So there's a group of there's an office on campus that you only exclusively works with them. And for everything else, well, I mentioned before the Intensive English Language Institute for, again, English language learners only, but as far as a full-time student, for every other students, we really try to obviously have our international population be part of the rest of the population of the university. So international students obviously can benefit from all the housing services, all the student life, trips, activities on campus, volunteering office, our athletics department. They can participate in sports activities on campus as well, performing arts, as I mentioned before. So they really become part of the core of the university, where all other students belongs to as well.
Great, thank you so much. Well, Francesca, I want to thank you and Manuela for the presentation. And the emails are right here if anyone watching the webinar has more questions. All right, so have a great afternoon, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.